a very good evening to all of you. On behalf of AOC and Web Academy, I welcome you all to a very interesting session, which is on basics of localization in neurology by Dr. Divyani Garg. She is a DM in neurology and DNB neurology and presently working as assistant professor in neurology at Lady Harding Medical College. So over to you, Divyani.
Thank you, ma'am. Am I audible, ma'am?
Yeah.
Okay. So welcome everybody to this talk, and I think that this is really important. I understand that most of the audience is comprises postgraduate students. So I think those of you who are exam going, this would be a quick revision, and I think that this is actually the basis of clinical diagnosis making in neurology. I think that the basic precepts of localization that hold true for adult patients also hold true for the older children. There are a few things in this talk that I will cover and some things that I will not cover. For example, higher mental functions and cranial nerve localization in detail, I will not be covering this because I don't think that's very relevant for the pediatrics, this thing. But you can always go back and read up on it. Those are very interesting things. So I'll just tell you the key points of this talk. So of course, we've been taught the minute that we've decided that we want to take up neurology or deal with a neurological patient, the raging question is, where is the lesion? And of course, to answer this question, one must have knowledge of very relevant neuroanatomy and physiology. And while we've been taught right from our MBBS days that history taking is crucial, and it is, in terms of localization, I have to tell you that examination is probably equally, if not more important. And whereas history taking would point towards etiology of a diagnosis, examination would actually help you to make a localization. And the whole exercise is, of course, to choose appropriately our investigative modalities and not be very broad spectrum about it. So just taking you briefly through a history of localization. So this actually is engendered within the field of aphasia, which in itself is very interesting. And actually the concept of aphasia has its documentation even from Egyptian papyrian scrolls, where it has been documented that individuals who had a left temporal bone fracture were unable to speak and things like that. But for the longest time, actually, it was believed that paired organs in the body had identical functions. What I mean by that is that it was believed that the right and the left hemispheres of the brain had exactly identical functions. It's just that they were on two sides. But this concept was actually revolutionized by this gentleman whose portrait is in the center, that is Paul Broca. And he was the first person to suggest that, it is not that way. And he said that injury to the left inferior frontal gyrus could lead to a syndrome which he called aphemia, and which we now know as Broca's aphasia. His work was further propounded by Carl Wernicke. And this is the diagram of Carl Wernicke that he himself drew, suggesting that lesions in the superior temporal gyrus would lead to a form of sensory aphasia. So actually localization started off with a description of aphasia and its anatomical correlates in the brain. So clinical diagnosis making in neurology actually consists of three steps. First, of course, is recognition of impaired function. So recognition of impaired function requires that one must understand and recognize what lies within the spectrum of what we understand as normal, and what lies outside the spectrum of normal, including what could be described as a functional neurological disorder. So for example, you recognize that a patient has a right hemiparesis. Localization is actually the second step, where you decide that this particular functional deficit could arise from a particular anatomical structure, for which of course relevant neuroanatomy must be known. So for example, let's say that this could be the left internal capsule. The third step of clinical diagnosis making is differential diagnosis.
So just a minute. Divyani, can you be a little louder and a little slower? So because sometimes the voice becomes a little muzzled.
Right. Yeah. So, So the third step in clinical diagnosis is actually differential diagnosis making. And the list of differential diagnosis would be generated entirely based on the history that you are able to elicit. So for an example, let's say that our same patient has a right hemiparesis. This could arise, so the history could be that this was a very abrupt onset right hemiparesis, which was maximum at onset and has subsequently shown some improvement over the next 2 or 3 weeks. versus a history of, say, evolving right hemiparesis, which has an insidious onset and is still progressing. So obviously, in the former case, you would evoke a vascular etiology like stroke. And in the latter, you would evoke a process which is evolving, such as a tumor or a demyelination. So your differential diagnosis list actually comes from history. And finally, of course, the fourth step, which is not clinical, but is, of course, very important, where you select the most appropriate modality to investigate that patient. So in this case, we might decide through a neuroimaging, which would tell us whether this was a tumor or it was a stroke. So this is the whole process. So we are focused on the second step, which is localization today. Before I take you into the nitty-gritties of localization, let me give you a few key concepts. So I think this is one of my favorite concepts, and it's important for you also to understand this. Let's presume that the structure that is giving rise to a problem lies at the center of two intersecting crossroads. So there are certain syndromes that come in with a direct address. So if a patient comes in with a history of tremor, rigidity, hypokinesia, postural instability, you immediately know that this is a Parkinsonism syndrome, and that the anatomical correlate is likely to involve the nigrostriatal circuitry. However, going back to our same patient who had a right hemiparesis, there are a variety of structures which could give rise to a right hemiparesis. So you must look at where there is an intersection of the crossroads. What do I mean by that? Let's say the patient with a right hemiparesis has a left third nerve palsy. There is only one area in the brain where this combination can arise from, and that is the left midbrain. So in short, one can use the presence of adjacent structural involvement in order to localize. So that is the first concept. Second concept is that localization in general tends to be more precise when the lesion affects lower levels of the nervous system. What do I mean by that? Let's say we have a patient who has an ulnar neuropathy post-trauma. And let's say we have a second patient who has an aphasia. When you examine the patient with ulnar neuropathy on day 1 or day 2 or day 3, the symptoms and signs that the patient has are not going to change. They will have weakness of the small muscles of the hand supplied by the ulnar nerve. They will have a sensory deficit that is on the pattern of the ulnar nerve. But if you have the patient with, say, Broca's aphasia or Wernicke's aphasia, this is not precise because we know that these patients, they tend to give variable responses to the same questions on day 1, on day 2, and day 3. This doesn't change the localization. It's just that this is a feature that as you go lower down into the neuraxis, the lesions tend to become more precise. And this is similar to the third concept, which is that lesions of lower levels tend to change little and higher levels may be inconsistent. Of course, these are just broad concepts, but these are useful to remember. And I cannot stress this enough. Examination is of utmost importance, and please hone your examination skills, use appropriate instruments, because this is the most important facet of localization. The final concept is that one must, of course, at the end of our history taking and examination, decide whether this is a single discrete lesion or there is more than one lesion. So once we have made up our diagnosis, the list of differentials and our localization, these are the three questions that you must keep going back to and keep asking yourself. What is the necessary minimal amount of neuroanatomy that must be damaged to produce the patient's symptoms or signs? Remember that we are talking about brevity. Brevity means that it must be minimal amount of tissue. We don't want to invoke unnecessarily huge lesions unless absolutely clinically required. And if the lesion is where you think it is, does it explain all the findings? You must be able to explain all the findings with your anatomical localization. Because if you are not able to explain those, then it is likely that your localization is wrong. It is likely that you are missing something on history or on your examination. And additionally, and this is also very important, if the lesion is here, what else must be present? Well, that is, if you have a particular lesion, it is likely that there could be certain expected neighborhood signs that would go along with this localization, and you must look for those and elicit those as well. Okay, so now we will go into localization in the various systems. So this is localization in the motor system. The basic concept here is that when a patient comes to you with a problem of the motor system, one must decide whether it is an upper motor neuron lesion or it is a lower motor neuron lesion. So patient with a motor system problem will present with a variety of motor symptoms. These are usually weakness, but these could also be tone abnormalities, or it could be atrophy, or it could be fasciculations. It could be a variety of things. But if it is the motor system, the first thing to decide is whether it is an upper motor neuron problem or it is a lower motor neuron problem. So what do I mean when I say UMN and LMN? We use these terms a lot. So you must know the relevant neuroanatomy. So the first thing to remember is what comprises the upper motor neuron. So these are all the tracts that start off in the motor cortex, most of the time in the motor cortex, and travel all the way in the form of the corticospinal tract to the level of the anterior horn cell. So the corticospinal tract, it starts, 40% of the fibers begin in the motor cortex, broadmean area 4, but they also have their origin in the supplementary motor area, the premotor cortex, and some of it also from the sensory cortex, that is broadmean area 3, 1, and 2. All of these fibers form the corticospinal tract, and they travel through the subcortical white matter in the form of corona radiata, and then subsequently in the form of the internal capsule, as you see here, and then through the brainstem in the midbrain in the form of cerebral peduncles, and then through the basis pontus, and then in the medulla, where there is a decussation of the motor fibers. So the medullary decussation or the motor decussation, 90% of the corticospinal tract fibers do decussate at the level of the medulla and proceed as the lateral corticospinal tract into the spinal cord. 10% of these remain undecussated at the level of the medulla and they proceed as the anterior corticospinal tract. However, do remember that even most of these fibers that belong to the anterior corticospinal tract do decussate eventually at the level of the spinal cord, such that only around 2% of the corticospinal tract finally remains undecussated. This undecussated tract has a function. It actually goes and supplies the axial musculature and some of the proximal musculature. So this entire pathway from the motor cortex and adjacent regions through the subcortical white matter, internal capsule, brainstem, decussation, and up to the level of just synapsing above the anterior horn cell is called the upper motor neuron. So the lower motor neuron starts off with the anterior horn cell in the spinal cord, which lies in the anterior horn. And fibers from here, the axons, they traverse in the anterior ventral root, which is the motor root, connect with fibers from the posterior sensory root and form the spinal nerve. The spinal nerve, it forms the anterior and the posterior rami. The posterior rami travel and supply the paraspinal muscles, and the anterior rami in the cervical region contribute to the brachial plexus, and in the leg lower limbs contribute to the lumbosacral plexus and form the peripheral nerves. And the peripheral nerves subsequently travel all the way. The axons will connect with the muscle at the neuromuscular junction and then finally the muscle. So this is your lower motor neuron from the anterior horn cell all the way up to the level of the muscle. I want you to know that although we keep talking about the corticospinal tract, it is not just the corticospinal tract which is contributing to your limb tone, and there are a number of descending pathways that actually contribute to this. So there are four major other pathways, like the rubrospinal tract, the reticulospinal tract, the vestibulospinal tract, and the tectospinal tract. And these variably stimulate flexors and extensors. I will actually not go into details of this. I think this might have been covered on the talk on coma, which the preferential involvement of various tracts contributes to decorticate and decerebrate posturing. But just know that descending pathways is not just the corticospinal tract. Although when we talk about the upper motor neuron, we are talking about the corticospinal tract. So this is the summary, and I just want you to remember each of these levels of the neuraxis every time you think of a motor problem in terms of UMN or LMN. UMN is cortex, subcortex, brainstem, spinal cord. LMN is anterior horn cell, root, spinal nerve, plexus, peripheral nerve, neuromuscular junction, and muscle. So how do we do a differentiation? I find that it is most useful to use, actually there are a lot of differences that are described, but the most useful at the bedside are actually tone and deep tendon reflexes. So you know that in an upper motor neuron lesion, patients have spasticity, and in lower motor neuron lesions, there is a loss of tone or hypotonia. From the point of view of exams, examiners like to ask what spasticity, what are the chief features of spasticity. So there are certain words that you must use. So the first of these is that it is velocity dependent, which means that the faster you try to move a limb in a passive fashion to elicit tone, the more likely you are to pick up spasticity, the more prominent it becomes. The second word you must use is clasp knife phenomenon. So there is a sudden giving way when you exert force. And the third is the pattern of weakness that is a part of the UMN, which is also known, which people call pyramidal pattern of weakness. So examiners are very fond of asking which are the muscles that are affected by the pyramidal pattern of weakness. So for this, I think it's most useful to remember the hemiplegic posture. So if you think of the upper limb that you know that the arm, the shoulder tends to be abducted and the elbow tends to be flexed and the wrist and the fingers tend to be flexed. So all the opposite muscles, that is the extensors of the upper limbs, are the weak ones. And similarly, the lower limb tends to stay extended in a hemiplegic posture. So it is the flexors of the lower limbs that are affected by the weakness that is part of the pyramidal pattern. Okay, so that is point number one. Second thing is deep tendon reflexes. So you know that in upper motor neuron lesions, because there is loss of the descending inhibitory pathways, there is a sort of disinhibition of the lower motor neuron and there tends to be a hyperreflexia, which is hyperreflexia or areflexia in the lower motor neuron lesion. But it is not actually sufficient to say hyperreflexia. We know that this is a little subjective. So you must be able to elicit clear-cut signs of hyperreflexia. So those are that the presence of pathological reflexes. For example, the presence of pathological reflexes clearly points to hyperreflexia. You must know what pathological reflexes are. As an example, in the upper limb, it could be Hoffman's, Stromner's, finger flexors, trapezius, pectoralis reflex, and so on and so forth in the lower limb. So if these are present, there is no doubt that there is hyperreflexia. If there is a presence of a Babinski sign, an extensor plantar, it suggests presence of hyperreflexia. And if you have, in addition, you must ask for history of flexor spasms. Sometimes those are extensor spasms, but mostly flexor spasms, as well as the presence of clonus. So these four things must be elicited within the spectrum of tendon reflexes, so as to speak. So that would point towards an upper motor neuron kind of lesion. And of course, there are certain ancillary features, which, for example, superficial reflexes may be absent in an upper motor neuron lesion. But you know that depends if there is a flabby abdomen or it's a post-surgical abdomen, then you may not actually be able to use this sign. But if it is present, then definitely it is present in a lower motor neuron lesion. So I would go back and just revise this slide by saying that please use tone and use deep tendon reflexes to decide whether the lesion, the motor problem, is an upper motor neuron type or a lower motor neuron type. So let's just go through a few clinical examples just to make this concept very clear to you. So let's say that a patient comes in with hemiplegia of one side, say the right upper limb and the right lower limb. How do you approach a patient with hemiplegia? We have, so hemiplegia is going to be an upper motor neuron problem. And as we have said, the upper motor neuron can either arise from the problem can arise from the cortex or the subcortical structures, that is the corona radiata or the internal capsule, or the corticospinal tract as it passes through the brainstem, or even up to the level of the spinal cord, but above the anterior horn cell. So how do you make a decision over here? So the first thing is to note whether the person has a facial involvement. If the person does not have facial involvement, then any structure that is at the level of the pons, where you know that the facial nucleus lies and above, is not going to be responsible for this person's hemiplegia. Because if that were the case, facial involvement must be a part of the problem. So then in that case, the problem could be in the medulla or it could be at the level of the cervical spinal cord. However, please, I just want to mention that, you know, even in the medulla, there are certain descending fibers of the facial nerve that travel, which is why sometimes you have facial involvement in the lateral medullary syndrome. So we don't take medulla actually as an area where, you know, just pure facial nerve involvement cannot exist. It can exist even in a medullary lesion. So, but anyhow, if you do not have facial involvement, then most likely the patient has a hemiplegia because of a cord problem. if the patient has a facial involvement, you have to decide whether it is the facial involvement is of the upper motor neuron type or the lower motor neuron type. I will not cover that. You have been taught that from your MBBS days, how to differentiate a UMN facial from an element facial. But if the patient has an element facial, automatically you have to look for whether that cranial nerve involvement is crossed or uncrossed. Crossed means that the cranial nerve involvement is on one side and your hemiplegia is on the opposite side. This is a hallmark feature of brainstem lesions. So if you have an element a seventh on the left side and a hemiplegia on the right side, then your lesion localization is to the pons on the left side. If you have a UMN facial with a hemiplegia, then how do you decide whether it is cortex or subcortex? In this case, you have to decide upon whether the hemiplegia and the facial involvement are proportionate or disproportionate. So that is why I was stressing that examination is actually really important in these cases. Proportionate or disproportionate, you may know this as dense hemiplegia or non-dense hemiplegia. So proportionate hemiplegia means that the upper limb and the lower limb involvement are equal, so that if there is a grade 3/5 power in the upper limb, there is also a grade 3/5 power in the lower limb. And disproportionate means that either the upper limb is more affected, that is weaker, or the lower limb is more affected. So let's take these scenarios. So if you have a disproportionate hemiplegia, where you have a weakness that is more in the upper limb and the face. So I want to take you to this homunculus. This is the motor homunculus. The representation is such that the face and the upper limb lie on the lateral aspect of the cortex and the lower limb actually goes on to the medial aspect of the cortex. So if you have a weakness which is more prominent in the upper limb and the face, then it is likely to arise from the lateral aspect of the cortex, which is an area supplied by the middle cerebral artery. And if there is more lower limb weakness, then that is a feature of a medial cortical lesion, which is the area supplied by the anterior cerebral artery. You can ask me, why is it not internal capsule in this case? That is very simple. If you see the internal capsule, it's a really dense structure. The fibers have come together. The corticospinal tract travels through the posterior limb of the internal capsule and the corticobulbar fibers travel through the genu of the internal capsule. So if there is a lesion in the internal capsule, it is very likely that both the upper limb and the lower limb fibers will be affected simultaneously and equally, which is why the hemiplegia from an internal capsule lesion is described as proportionate or dense. Why not subcortical? Well, subcortical lesions can also have a disproportionate hemiplegia. So how to differentiate cortex from subcortex? In that case, you have to elicit neighborhood signs of cortical involvement. These people can have aphasias if it is involving the left hemisphere. They can have other cortical signs like cortical sensory loss, etc. So then in this case, you have to look for neighborhood signs. So that is the concept of localization in hemiplegia. Now, this brings me to a very important part of localization. And so we have finished upper motor neuron up till the level of the corticospinal tract, up to the level of the cord. Brainstem, I have given you a concept that there tends to be a crossed pattern of involvement. But myelopathy, I think, is a whole talk in itself. However, to give you a basic concept, whenever you localize to the spinal cord, you have to give the vertical localization and the horizontal localization. By vertical localization, I mean you have to tell us which is the highest level of involvement in the cord from the cervical region up to the lumbosacral region. And by the horizontal extent, I mean where exactly is the lesion, whether it is intramedullary or whether it is extramedullary. So we will discuss all of these concepts. So you must know the anatomy of the spinal cord. Actually, I think you must know how to draw the anatomy of the cross-section of the cord, because examiners are fond of asking where various cords lie within the cord. So various tracts lie within the cord, I'm sorry. So few things you must concentrate on. First is the lateral corticospinal tract, because you know that this is responsible for motor function. So this is your descending tract here. Then the ventral or the anterior corticospinal tract lies here. So that is for the motor part. At least you must know this. And in terms of the ascending pathways or the sensory pathways, you must know the lateral spinothalamic tract and the ventral spinothalamic tract. These two tracts together form what we call the anterolateral system and subserve the modalities of touch, pain, non-discriminative touch, as well as pressure. And then this is the posterior column. So the gracile fasciculus lies medially and the cuneate fasciculus lies laterally. And these observe the modalities of proprioception, joint position, sense, vibration, and fine touch. So just try to remember this basic anatomy and a few other points that I will make now. So do remember, this is the spinothalamic tract, okay? So when the fibers, they enter from the sensory root through the dorsal root ganglion into this, the posterior aspect of the cord, and this is the substantia gelatinosa, the fibers actually decussate immediately over here. Actually, they climb one or two levels above or below the level of entry into the cord. That is called Lissajous tract. And after that, they actually decussate at the level of the cord, traveling through the anterior funiculus of the cord, whether in the white matter or the gray matter, but very close to the central canal. This is the point that you must remember. Very close to the central canal, and subsequently they take up their respective positions in the anterior lateral system and travel all the way up through the cord to the thalamus. So that is about your anterior lateral system. And then you have the posterior column. So posterior column is less complicated. Posterior column, actually, the fibers, the afferent fibers come in through the dorsal root and directly go into the fasciculus gracile and fasciculus cuneatus. And they travel up all the way to the level of the medulla. At the level of the medulla, just like there is a motor decussation, there is a sensory decussation. And subsequently, the sensory fibers from the posterior column travel in the form of the medial lemniscus. So even the sensory fibers eventually are decussating, as you see. So this is, these are two things that you have to remember. And then this is an extremely important thing to remember as far as cord lesions are concerned, which is the lamination of the tracts. All the tracts in the body have a somatotopic organization. Even the corticospinal tract that we just went through has a somatotopic organization. But from the point of view of a myelopathy, it is very important that you remember the lamination of these tracts. So broadly, the lateral corticospinal tract, and the spinothalamic tract, that is the anterior lateral system, the cervical fibers lie inside and the sacral fibers lie outside. This will become very apparent to you when we discuss the various lesions of the cord. And in the posterior column, it is so the sacral fibers join at the lowest extent of the cord, and as the fibers keep joining from the higher levels, they keep joining on the outer aspect. So the cervical fibers tend to lie towards the outer aspect and the sacral fibers lie medialmost in the posterior column. So these are the patterns of myelopathy. Just focus on the first six joints here. And when somebody asks you what are the hard points to suggest myelopathy, you cannot just say hyperreflexia, hypertonia, going plantar, etc., etc. The presence of these spinal cord patterns are the hard features of myelopathy, okay? So sensory level, for example. So if you have a lesion that causes complete transection of the cord, then that will lead to a complete motor paralysis below the level of the lesion. It will lead to complete loss of modalities of anterior lateral system and the posterior column below the level of the lesion. So this is really simple. Let's go on to the hemisection of the cord. You all know that this is called the Brown-Sicard syndrome. So in the hemisection of the cord, what happens is at the level of the, so here in this figure, they have shown that the lesion is at T3. So at T3 level, all modalities of sensation would be lost. Below the level of the lesion, what happens is that, you know, that the posterior column travels in an ipsilateral fashion. So you will have a loss of joint position, sense, and vibration below the level of the lesion on the same side, but of the spinothalamic modalities of sensation on the contralateral side. Of course, weakness will also be on the same side, that is in the right lower limb and the right aspect of the trunk. Okay, now this concept is important. So this is called a suspended sensory loss. And this is a hallmark feature of an intraaxial lesion. So let's say you have the syrinx, or you have a tumor that is expanding from inside outwards. Let's say a syrinx, which is expanding the central canal from inside, and it is expanding in an outward fashion. So if you remember, I told you that the spinothalamic fibers, they traverse and decussate very close to the central canal. So these are actually the first fibers to be affected in an intraaxial lesion. So if the lesion is extending from say T3 to T6, in those segments, there will be a loss of these spinothalamic sensations. And remember that the posterior column is actually lying behind. So the lesion actually has to expand a lot in order to affect the posterior column. So this leads to a pattern which is called a dissociation of sensory loss, which means that you have a preservation of posterior cord posterior column sensations, but you have a loss of the spinothalamic sensations. So suspended sensory loss and dissociation of sensory loss are both features that suggest an intraaxial lesion, an early intraaxial lesion. But when the intraaxial lesion becomes fairly advanced, it is going to, of course, involve the posterior column also. So both the modalities will be affected, posterior column and spinothalamic tract. But again, remember I told you that in the spinothalamic tract, the sacral fibers tend to lie most laterally. And even in the posterior column, it's these fibers that are, they tend to be affected very late in an intraaxial lesion. So as a result, there tends to be sacral sparing. This is another pattern which is seen in an anterior spinal cord syndrome. And in this, what happens is that the anterior spinal artery supplies the anterior 2/3 of the cord and the posterior spinal artery supplies the posterior 1/3 of the cord. So what tends to happen is that there is a loss of, or let's say there is an involvement of the anterolateral system, but also of the lateral corticospinal tract that lies approximately here. So as a result, there is both weakness below the level of the lesion as well as loss of the spinothalamic modalities below the level of the lesion. But again, the posterior column sensations remain intact. And then, of course, you have the caudal equina. I will talk about the conus and cauda in detail. So we will talk about that pattern there. So just remember that these are the various patterns of spinal cord involvement. So as of now, we have discussed a combination of vertical and horizontal extent, but this you have to also tell us whether it is an horizontally where the lesion is located. So you know that it could be either intramedullary, which is within the substance of the cord, or it could be extramedullary. Now, extramedullary lesions further are because the dura is a hard structure and it is not it's quite firm and doesn't move about too much. That is used to categorize extramedullary lesions further as intradural or extradural. Okay, so this is a pictorial representation. So this is an intramedullary lesion. Here between the dura and the cord would be an extramedullary but an intradural lesion. And finally, out of the dura is an extradural lesion. So how do we decide clinically whether the lesion is? So first we decide whether it is extramedullary or intramedullary. Okay, so then there are certain features that are immediately come to mind. So in an extramedullary lesion, particularly if it is intradural, remember that the roots traverse through this region and lesions that affect this area are likely to affect the roots. So these people have very typical, very severe radicular pain, which is a radiating pain that travels down the extent of the root, and it is an early feature. Whereas in an intramedullary lesion, because of the involvement of the spinothalamic tract or maybe even the posterior column, there is a very ill-defined, burning kind of, diffuse kind of pain. Patients often describe it as, binding down of their legs or their trunk, and this is called a funicular pain. So there is a difference in the character of the pain. Then there are a few other things. I think instead of this table, let me take you to this table. Yeah, so when you examine the patient further, remember that in an extramedullary lesion, UMN signs tend to be more common because the corticospinal tract lies slightly outer aspect, so it tends to get affected. Whereas in an intramedullary lesion, it is the sensory problems that are happening for sensory loss and loss of spinothalamic sensations. And the motor involvement comes in later in the disease. Also in an intramedullary lesion, usually a syrinx, it tends to grow a lot within the cord before it starts compressing outwards. So the element signs tend to be pretty prominent in an intramedullary lesion where compared to an extramedullary lesion. Sensory findings, I've already told you, root pain is a feature of extramedullary and funicular pain is a feature of intramedullary lesions. Dissociated sensory loss, if it is present, we've discussed this, it is going to be present in an intramedullary lesion. Sacral sensation, if it is lost, it is more likely because sacral fibers lie outside, extramedullary lesions are outside. So loss of sacral sensation is a feature of extramedullary and early feature. In intramedullary, sacral sensations tend to be preserved till really late. And then there's something called the Lermite sign. Lermite sign is actually a symptom. It's not a sign, although it is called a sign. So Lermite sign is basically a condition where, it is classically described that on neck flexion and sometimes even on neck extension, there is an immediate electric current that passes through the back and sometimes even the limbs. And basically what it suggests is very simply that there is a problem in the posterior column. And this problem in the posterior column, obviously the localization is to the cord. Other than this, it doesn't tell you anything. So if Lermite sign is present, there is an involvement of the posterior column in the cord. Doesn't tell you anything about etiology. Earlier, it used to be described in multiple sclerosis patients, but we know that there are several conditions where Lermite sign can actually happen. Autonomic involvement. Okay, so autonomic involvement. So if you look at the cross-section of the cord, then the autonomic fibers actually travel in the intermediolateral column, which is over here, autonomic fibers to the bowel and the bladder. So obviously they will also be affected much earlier in an intramedullary lesion compared to an extramedullary lesion. Okay, now I will tell you a little bit about conus and cauda. So basically what happens is that the vertebral column, it tends to outgrow the growth of the spinal cord. So as a result, what happens is that the spinal cord, it actually ends in an adult between L1 and L2 vertebral levels. And the lowermost end of the cord is the conus medullaris, which consists of the sacral segments and all the nerve roots that travel downwards from L2 onwards. Travel down in the form of this horse tail appearance structure, which is called the cauda equina. The name is inspired by the term horse tail. And I think that it is mostly what we see clinically is that conus and cauda lesions tend to often occur hand in hand, but still you must be able to differentiate conus versus cauda. And this is also, I think, a favorite question of examiners. So conus medullaris, remember, it's a spinal cord syndrome. Cauda equina is a root syndrome. So cauda equina is going to be element kinds. Okay, conus is going to have UMN features. So that is a basic concept, but just going through certain details. So conus medullaris pain, as you know, is not a feature of cord other than a funicular pain. So if they do have pain, it's going to be diffuse and bilateral, and it is going to be confined to the perineum because that's the area of supply of the sacral region. And cauda equina, of course, will have severe radicular kind of pain, and the pain distribution will depend upon the roots that are affected. In terms of sensory deficit, both of these will cause a deficit in the saddle distribution, because you just think of S2, S3, S4, that's the perianal region, so that's the saddle area. So, but in a conus, because it's a really small structure, right, it's compact, so the involvement is likely to be bilateral. So there is likely to be a bilateral saddle anesthesia, symmetric, and just like an intrinsic cord problem, there may be dissociation of sensation. But in a cauda equina, because the roots on one side may be affected more than roots on the other side, it may be unilateral or it may be asymmetric. And of course, all modalities of sensation will be affected, because you know that roots carry all modalities of sensation. Motor loss, similarly, in conus, actually, since it is an S2, S3, S4 kind of problem, you know that lower limbs are really not supplied so much by that. So you may have some weakness, but it's not marked as compared to cauda equina, because hip flexion onwards is all lumbar. And so here the weakness is prominent, and in fact, atrophy may also set in, and it is asymmetric. So it's an asymmetric problem. Reflex loss in conus because of S1, if it is affected, and only the ankle jerk may be lost. But in cauda, of course, knee and ankle may be lost. But bowel and bladder involvement, just like any other cord syndrome, are early and marked in conus. But these would be late and less marked in the cauda. And of course, the last point being onset is sudden and bilateral, usually because the conus problem is because of a disc. Cauda may be because of certain infiltrative or infective etiologies like tuberculosis or malignancy. So that's why the onset and the progression may be gradual in a cauda equina compared to a conus. Okay, so now I will take you into bladder localization. Once again, this is a talk in itself, but certain basic concepts about how to approach bladder localization. So remember that there are four things I want you to remember. One is that there is a suprapontine control. Second is that there is control at the level of the pontine micturition center. Third is that there is a spinal cord, and fourth is in the spinal cord, specifically the S2, S3, S4 regions. So you remember these four regions. Let me just take you through the details of this. So basically, I have written frontal lobe here, but it is not just the frontal lobe. Actually, it's a lot of suprapontine centers, as we call them, that include the anterior cingulate gyrus, that include the periaqueductal gray matter, etc., etc. So these are actually responsible for making a decision on social appropriateness to avoid. And of course, this depends upon bladder training and all of those things. So social appropriateness to avoid. That is in the suprapontine control. Then we go on to the pontine micturition center, which is the major relay center. So this coordinates the signals from the suprapontine regions to the sacral spinal cord, so that voiding or storage or emptying of the bladder can be done depending upon the suprapontine control. And then of course you have the spinal cord, which is S2, S3, S4 is actually the major bladder control center. And in S2, S3, S4, there are three kinds of bladder control. So first is the parasympathetic supply. So parasympathetic through the pelvic nerves, just remember that this goes and supplies the bladder detrusor, which it excites, and it relaxes the internal urethral sphincter. So the parasympathetic control via the pelvic nerves is responsible for bladder emptying. The sympathetic system is via T10 to L2, the hypogastric nerves, and this carries out the opposite function. That is, it is inhibitory to the bladder detrusor and it is excitatory to the internal urethral sphincter. So it is responsible for storage of urine in the bladder. And finally, of course, bladder is a unique organ in the sense that there is voluntary control that can overrule over this parasympathetic sympathetic autonomic control, and that is through the somatic center, which also lies within S2 to S4, and via the pudendal nerves it controls the external urethral sphincter, which is a striated muscle, as well as the pelvic floor musculature, so that there can be storage can be maintained over the bladder. So bladder localization symptoms are of two kinds. There can be voiding symptoms and there can be storage symptoms. So voiding symptoms mean that there are difficulties with voiding. So there may be hesitancy, which means difficulty in initiating micturition, or there may be a slow stream, or there may be straining to void, or dribbling, or incomplete evacuation. And storage symptoms are difficulties with storage. So patients may have frequency, urgency, incontinence, nocturia, etc. So how do we approach a bladder problem? Okay, so I'll just take you back to this diagram. So I want you to think of bladder problems in the form of mainly three kinds. One is that there is a suprapontine bladder problem. So in a suprapontine, what happens is that there is loss of this inhibitory control of the cerebral cortex over the rest of the bladder control. So as a result, but remember that the bladder reflexes are maintained because the innervation from the bladder to the cord and back is maintained. But the inhibitory control from the cortex is lost. So this actually leads to what is called the uninhibited bladder. So in this, what happens is that social awareness, social disinhibition, and decision making based on social conditions is lost. And the micturition that does occur is just totally a reflex. And it is precipitous, which means it's sudden and it is complete. So there is no residual volume. The bladder voids completely, and the bladder voids in response to minor stretch reflex also. So if there is a minor filling, then the bladder will suddenly void. So there is frequency and there is urgency and there is urgent continence, and often it is associated with the loss of social embarrassment. Okay, however, there is normal sensation of bladder filling because of course the lower sensory reflex is intact. So the points to remember here are that the voiding is sudden and it is complete, and it is a UMN kind of bladder, complete UMN kind of bladder. So this is called the disinhibited or the uninhibited bladder. The second kind of bladder problem that happens is in the spinal cord, but above the level of the sacral level, that is S2, S3, S4. Above S2, S3, S4, there is a spinal cord lesion. Okay. So in this is easy to understand because this, obviously you know that this would be a UMN kind of bladder, but remember that the UMN is not just affecting the bladder. It is also causing an increase in tone of the external urethral sphincter and the pelvic floor musculature. So while your bladder is trying to contract, the external urethral sphincter is also trying to contract, and this leads to what is known as detrusor sphincter dyssynergia. So the bladder tone is increased and there is urgency frequency in incontinence, but there is also an interruption of urinary flow and there is also increased post-void residue. So this is what you have to remember. In spinal cord lesions above the level of S2, S3, S4, there is detrusor sphincter dyssynergia. And then finally, the third level, which is spinal cord lesions that involves S2, S3, S4. That is colloquially called autonomous bladder, and there is complete denervation of afferents, of efferents, so the bladder becomes an element kind of bladder. It is flaccid, atonic, it distends and distends with urine. There is no sensation because, of course, the sensory afferents have been totally interrupted. And there is therefore overflow incontinence, and patients may continue to just dribble urine because of overflow. And sometimes these patients will sense a fullness, in the sense that they don't actually sense bladder fullness, but they see a bump that is developing in the suprapubic region, which is because of bladder fullness. So they actually use a suprapubic pressure to avoid that is known as Creed's maneuver. So that is a feature of involvement of S2, S3, S4. So just remember these three things. It's really simple to remember if you think of it this way. Some people actually, because this is the older classification and it is based on urodynamic studies, some people also call a sensory deafferented bladder, which used to happen in patients who had syphilis like tabes dorsalis and pure sensory problems. So in this case, there is impaired bladder sensation, and however, there is voluntary control which is intact. So, these kind of patients are suggested that every 2 hours they should just go and void, even if they don't sense urine, so as to avoid urinary stasis and infections. And then the fifth final type of bladder is the motor paralytic bladder, which, like the sensory deafferented bladder, it's that there is loss of the motor fibers. So the bladder tone becomes flaccid, although sensation is intact. So these people, they will develop painful retention of urine because, of course, sensation is intact, but they're not able to start the motor activity of voiding. So bladder capacity is increased, and again, there is risk of urinary stasis and infection. So that is your bladder in a nutshell. Now, brainstem disease, I have already given you the concept. You have to look for crossed signs. So cranial nerves on one side, motor deficits on the opposite side. But of course, there can also be other things that are affected. So cerebellar peduncles can be affected, giving rise to ataxia, et cetera, et cetera. So you have to look for that. And the reflexes and all of these conditions would be hyperactive. So, okay, brainstem, you should know the cross sections broadly. So this is the midbrain. And the structures I want you to focus on are the third cranial nerve, which is crossing forward like this, the red nucleus, which lies in the midbrain, and then, of course, the crust cerebri, which actually comprises corticospinal fibers, corticobulbar fibers, etc. So when we talk about this syndrome called Weber syndrome, that's the easiest of the name syndromes to remember. I don't think you need to remember the name syndromes, but just have the broad concept. Weber syndrome, however, consists of a third nerve involvement, which will happen, so let's say, on this side. But since there is also the involvement of the cerebral peduncle, you know that in the medulla, it will decussate and cross over to the opposite side. So third nerve on one side and motor weakness on the opposite side. So that is a cross syndrome called Weber's. This is the cross section of the pons. So you must not forget that the sixth and the seventh nerve lie here, and that the middle cerebellar peduncle also is connects the pons to the cerebellum. And then, of course, you have anterior most the corticonuclei and corticospinal fibers. And the medulla is a big complicated structure, but just remember the cranial nerves that lie in each of these, and that there is a cross syndrome that happens in the brainstem. So I'm not going to go into details of this. I'll just give you a 5-second break to recover because we've just finished the UMN syndromes, and now we will be going on to the lower motor neuron syndromes. So lower motor neuron, I think, is clinically easier to localize than the upper motor neuron. And this is because they all come with very typical hallmark features, right? So if you have an anterior horn cell problem, wasting is profoundly out of proportion to weakness. This does not mean, so what is the history that you have to ask? The history that you have to ask is that when the patient came in with a weakness to you, patients will come in with weakness to you most of the time because that will hamper their function, remember? So there is impaired function. But at that time, you have to ask that at the time that the patient noted that there was weakness, did he already have wasting at that time? So that is what is called wasting out of proportion to weakness. Then, of course, fasciculation. See, fasciculations can arise from anything in the lower motor neuron, ranging from the anterior horn cell or to the peripheral nerve. But of course, anterior horn cell is one condition where these are very common. And you know that these syndromes can be UMN, they can be LMN, they can be UMN plus LMN also. root, you have to look for pain. You have to ask for pain. If pain is not there, it is very unlikely to be root. It is not likely to be root at all. And of course, here motor and sensory both are affected. But remember that because sensory dermatomes tend to have an overlapping nature, the sensory loss may be patchy or may not be elicited as well. Okay, so that is there. And of course, since it's an element syndrome, other features like absent reflexes or depressed reflexes will be there. And in a root, if you suspect root, you have to ask for bowel, bladder, and also look for pathological reflexes, because that would tell you that there is involvement of the cord, adjacent cord as well. So it could be a myeloradiculopathy. Plexus, of course, these are also motor and sensory syndromes. And depressed or absent DTRs. Plexus, of course, it could be pan plexus, it could be partial plexus. So those patterns are all well known. And then the nerve is also a motor and sensory problem. Typically, the neuropathies tend to be symmetrical, distal, and they may have pain, they may have anesthesia, hyposthesia, and there are different patterns, three patterns mainly, polyneuropathy or mononeuropathy, in which you can have a multiple mononeuropathy pattern as well. But in a nerve, you have to actually clinically decide whether it is demyelinating or axonal. Okay, so how do you differentiate an axonopathy from a myelinopathy? So let's just take an example of an axonopathy. Just think of any nerve problem, which is a glove and stocking kind of neuropathy. So in adults, we think of a diabetic neuropathy, and a myelinopathy, we typically think of an AIDP. So just think of those and then think of the differences in those. So the important things are that axonopathies, by and large, they tend to have a slow recovery. This is because Wallerian degeneration sets in axonal problems. And the myelin problems tend to recover more faster in recovery. And the pattern of loss is, of course, a length-dependent pattern. The longest fibers tend to be affected first. So, you know, the reflexes that are lost may first be in the ankle jerks, then the knee jerks, and so on and so forth. Whereas in a myelinopathy, there tends to be more of a global loss of reflexes. And of course, then there are ancillary features such as, in an AIDP patient, if you think of it, then they may have a cranial nerve problem, they may have racias of proteins, etc. So the few things that you have to remember is, one is the length-dependent pattern of involvement in an axonopathy, the slower onset and recovery in an axonopathy compared to a myelinopathy, and there tends to be a reflex involvement, which is from distal to proximal, compared to a myelinopathy, which is a more global loss of reflexes. All right. So then the neuromuscular junction, these are pure motor. Now we've come to pure motor. Neuromuscular junction and muscle problems are pure motor in the element. Everything else has a combination and anterior horn cell. So plexus, root, and nerve are motor sensory, and pure motor are anterior horn cell, neuromuscular junction, and muscle. So this is also pure motor syndrome, typically proximal symmetrical. And of course, bulbar and extraocular muscle involvement is typical. You have to elicit for two things, fatigability. So with exertion, there is a worsening of the weakness and fluctuation, which means that through the day, there is a fluctuation of weakness. So when they wake up, they're better. By the time it is evening, they're worse. With activity, they're worse. So this fatigability and fluctuation are words that have to be used for neuromuscular junction problems. Then element muscle is, of course, obviously pure motor, and it is proximal and symmetric. There may be atrophy, there may be pseudo-hypertrophy like you see in dystrophinopathies or LGMDs. Myotonia is a feature in favor of muscle. You have to know how to elicit myotonia. And of course, having said that it is a typical proximal symmetric problem, we do know that there are exceptions to this. You can have distal myopathies, you can have scapulo-peroneal patterns where proximal upper limb and distal lower limb are affected, and so on and so forth. Of course, there are caveats to all of these localizations. And I will just go through this very quickly because we've already discussed a lot of this in the cord. So you know that broadly sensory is of two kinds of modalities, the spinothalamic system and the dorsal column. This is actually non-discriminative touch, not light touch. And this is discriminative touch, which is fine touch. Okay, and the pathways, we have already gone through this. You know that there is a decussation at the anterior lateral system at the level of the cord, and in the posterior column, there is a decussation at the level of the medulla, the sensory decussation. All of these ultimately end up in the thalamus, and from the thalamus, they end up in the sensory cortex in the pattern of the sensory homunculus. Okay, so localization in the sensory system, a lot of it is related to cord, but let's just talk about this. So if you have a stocking and glove pattern, that is in favor of neuropathy. If you have it confined to a root distribution, it is in favor of a radiculopathy. you can have a sensory level with a clear-cut transverse level that could happen in a spinal cord lesion. And we have discussed Brown's cord and central cord. This is suspended sensory loss. And then you can have this thalamic problem where you know that the face is equally affected, just as the upper limb and the lower limb. So this is a hemi body plus face syndrome. Okay, and I think this is one of the last things that I want to mention. So sensory ataxia, patient can come to you with sensory ataxia. There can be three possible localizations. Okay, one is that it is a large fiber sensory neuropathy. Second is at the level of the dorsal root ganglion. And third is that it could be a posterior column. So how do you decide? So posterior column, you look for other signs of spinal cord involvement. They could be bladder, they could be other things. We've already talked about myelopathies. How do you differentiate whether there is a large fiber sensory neuropathy or it is a dorsal root ganglion? Because they are really similar. They really resemble each other. So few things I want to tell you. In a dorsal root, in a ganglionopathy, the sensory ataxia is profound. Patients can't even sit because there is truncal ataxia and they will just sway from side to side. It is very intense, very severe compared to a sensory neuropathy. Second point is that the loss of reflexes is global. Whereas in large fiber, if they have a, you know, a glove and stocking pattern or a length dependent pattern, then it could be that the lower limbs are affected and the upper limbs are not affected. Third point is that the ganglions also affect the cranial ganglion. So there could be a trigeminal ganglionopathy in association with a whole body ganglionopathy. So you have to look for that also. So these are some of the pointers towards differentiating a large fiber neuropathy from a dorsal root ganglionopathy. Cerebellar disease, I will not go into the localization of this, but broadly I will tell you that when you say cerebellar localization, you have to describe the syndrome, whether it is hemispheric, whether it is vermian and paravermian, or it's the flocculonodular lobe, or it is pancerebellar, which means all structures are affected. So limb ataxias, your pass pointing, heel niche impairment, all of those come to cerebellar hemisphere. Your truncal titubation and midline syndromes come from the vermian structures, the vermis. The paravermian is responsible for cerebellar dysarthria broadly, and of course all the eye problems that are associated with cerebellar by and large are the flocculonodular lobe. So that is the cerebellar localization in a nutshell. So thanks, and I'll be happy to take any questions.
Yeah, Divyani, hello.
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah. Hello? So that was a very exhaustive talk. I think trying to cover everything in such a short span of time. And there are a few questions.
Yes.
Most of them were actually saying that you're going too fast, but then I think we can have a series of your lectures later.
I agree.
Because it was really very difficult to cover everything in such a...
Actually, each of the topics are a separate topic.
Yeah. So one person has asked, what is the pathway of the abdominal reflex? And its significance in upper motor neuron and lower motor neuron lesions.
That's a good question. Also, examiners are fond of that question.
Yeah.
So, unlike a deep tendon reflex, which is a monosynaptic pathway, right? There is an afferent, and then there is a synapse, and there is an efferent. The superficial abdominal reflex is a polysynaptic pathway, actually. So, it has a lot of influence of the upper motor neuron structures as such. So, just remember that it is a polysynaptic pathway. It travels all the way up, and in a UMN lesion, there is a loss because of this polysynaptic nature. Okay, having said that, you should also know that there are certain conditions where, despite it being an upper motor neuron lesion, the superficial abdominal reflex is preserved, such as in ALS.
So can you just tell in which conditions we will have it absent or asymmetry or...
Okay. So yeah, right. So if you have, if you have a spinal cord lesion, it's useful in myelopathy localization a lot. So let's say you have a spinal cord lesion, which is at the level of T10. Okay. So T10, is at the level of the umbilicus. So if you have a presence of the superficial abdominal reflexes above the umbilicus, but not below the umbilicus, then that would help you to localize. So the upper reflexes would be preserved and the lower abdominal reflexes would be lost.
Yeah. So the next question is, what is the difference between paresis and plegia?
Plegia is by and large a complete loss of power, and paresis is a partial loss of power. I don't think it's a very good idea to use these words when you're talking about plegia or paresis. It's best to use paresis and then describe the degree of power loss by the MRC grading.
Okay, next question is, why we in cauda equina syndrome do we have the bladder bowel involvement, which is late and less marked?
Okay, that's fine. See, listen, cauda equina, okay, so for that you have to know the bladder innervation, and you know, I have already taken you through that a little bit, but know that all the sensory afferents and efferents, they travel through the cauda equina. But for a bladder involvement to be profound, you have to lose all of those innervations. And cauda syndromes tend to be not as diffuse, okay? So they can be patchy. So you can have, say, L1, L3, and S1 affected, something like that. So that is why the bladder involvement, for it to happen, the loss of, or the involvement of the cauda roots has to be profound and severe at the same time, which is usually not what happens in a clinical scenario. But in a Kona syndrome, which is a small area, and all of the fibers are concentrated in that small area, any problem would lead to an immediate severe early loss of bladder, bowel.
Okay, what is the difference between exaggerated and brisk reflexes?
Okay, so that's again a very good question, because I think examiners like a particular kind of thing to be said and all of that. So don't use the term brisk, use the term exaggerated. But even if you're talking about exaggerated reflexes, I think it is best to describe your reflex. So when you're saying the knee jerk was exaggerated, you have to supplement it by saying that the knee jerk was exaggerated with patellar clonus or without patellar clonus. The ankle jerk was exaggerated with ankle clonus or without ankle clonus. I know that a lot of people use the grading of reflexes also. So +1, +2, +3, +4, that has totally fallen out of favor now. Do not use that. If you have to use the term, you can say exaggerated and then supplement it by saying presence or absence of clonus.
I think it also has to do with the area from which you can, you know, elicit the reflex. I think previously exaggerated was used for the increased area, like you can even elicit from the opposite side. Yeah. Okay. And the next question is, in case of dense hemiplegia, why do where the lesion is in internal capsule, why do some children present with seizures and loss of consciousness?
I really don't know why they present with seizures and loss of consciousness. I know for sure that in adults, this doesn't happen. See, I don't know if a capsular lesion can lead to these problems. Probably not. But if that's the case, I think you have to look for some other reason for, you know, such a clear cortical kind of syndrome of loss of consciousness and all of that.
I think it may be in the etiology itself. The etiology
definitely.
Is causing the,
meningitis
or so on.
Particular thing.
So how do we differentiate different speech problems like cerebellar versus a cortical dysarthria?
Okay.
Well,
I have to tell you that that is a whole seminar in itself. Once again, it's a great question. But see, cerebellar dysarthria, first of all, what do you mean by cortical dysarthria? There's nothing called cortical dysarthria. Dysarthria classification now is being, you know, divided into either a flaccid dysarthria or a spastic dysarthria or an extrapyramidal dysarthria or a cerebellar dysarthria or a mixed dysarthria. So there's nothing called cortical dysarthria, first of all. Okay, so if you're talking about a spastic dysarthria as opposed to a cerebellar dysarthria, then there are certain clinical features. So spastic dysarthria is typically an effortful speech, which is described as a hot potato voice. And a cerebellar dysarthria is typically described as an explosive speech with a staccato or a, you know, that kind of a dysarthria. So, of course, it lies all of it in the clinical features. Extrapyramidal is tends to be a fast hypophonic speech. And flaccid dysarthria is, of course, a very hypophonic slow speech and may be associated with other features of bulbar dysfunction.
Okay, another question is, what kind of the bladder, neurogenic bladder, will have the highest risk of getting infections?
Okay, so see, I took you through a range of bladder dysfunctions. But remember that wherever there is residual urine, there is going to be the risk of urinary stasis. So in the neurogenic bladder, such as the hypotonic bladder, which we talked about, S2, S3, S4 direct involvement, there is a loss of bladder tone and there is hypotonia and urinary stasis, so that there is an increased propensity to infections. But also know that in a detrusor sphincter dyssynergia issue, which we talked about, that is a suprasacral spinal cord problem, there is increased tone in the external urethral sphincter as well as a UMN kind of bladder. So while the bladder tries to contract, the external urethral sphincter doesn't permit it to contract. So there is a high chance of reflux with these people. Okay, so that is also a propensity towards infection. So it is believed that people who have detrusor sphincter dyssynergia actually have very high chances of urinary infection.
Another related question is, in meningomyelocele, which kind of neurogenic bladder is the most common?
Meningomyelocele, it really depends upon the extent of it. It could actually be a UMN plus LMN kind of bladder. I think LMN is common, but UMN plus LMN is also possible.
Okay, in which other conditions can we get Lermit's sign positive apart from MS?
Okay, very good question. I think because you could also be asked by some cunning examiner about this. So of course, you know that other than MS, so it has been reported in, even cervical disc disease. It has been reported with B12 deficiency. It has been reported with Arnold Chiari malformation. So basically, any structural problem which is affecting the posterior column. So, but I think off the top of my head, you can think of cervical disc and B12 deficiency and Arnold Chiari malformation. These are some of the other possibilities of Lermit's.
Another question is, in some AMAN cases, we can get exaggerated DTR reflexes.
10% of them, yeah.
Why? What may be the cause for that?
Okay, so see, the pathogenicity of this exaggerated reflexes in AMAN is not very clear, but it is believed that some of the antibodies that are present in AMAN, they actually go and attack the intramedullary neurons. So those are the upper motor neurons just before they are decussating, So that is responsible for causing disc reflexes by a UMN kind of thing secondary to an antibody-related pathogenicity. That is the most quoted reason for disc reflexes in 10% of the patients with AMAN.
Yeah, there are a lot of questions about hemiplegia. I'll just take one. What is the meaning of crossed versus uncrossed hemiplegia in relation to facial nerve?
Okay, fine. So crossed hemiplegia means that the seventh nerve involvement, okay, you're talking about with respect to facial nerve, right? So see, seventh nerve involvement on the same side as a hemiplegia clearly is an uncrossed hemiplegia, and that can arise from two kinds of problems. Okay, one is that it could be a UMN seventh with a hemiplegia, which you see in all of this internal capsule lesions, etc. The second could be that it is the the seventh nerve fibers as they loop into the medulla and go up. So medullary involvement can also lead to an uncrossed hemiplegia. Seventh LMN seventh, but that will be an LMN seventh. Okay, so LMN seventh and hemiplegia on the same side. And of course, if you have a crossed hemiplegia, it means that the seventh nerve is affected on one side. That is going to be an LMN seventh with a hemiplegia on the opposite side, such as a lesion in the pons.
Yeah. So another question is, can cerebellar lesions cause hemiplegia?
This thing of cerebellum on motor pathways other than in coordination, etc., is being more and more discovered. But by and large, it is not believed to cause hemiplegia. It does cause mutism. There is something called cerebellar mutism, but not hemiplegia. If there is hemiplegia, you have to invoke some other structure.
Yeah. Are there any false localizing signs?
Where?
Hemiplegia.
Okay. See, false localizing signs, apart from the raised ICP ones, there are a number of false localizing signs that have been described in the spinal cord also. Okay, so we know that there are conditions where there can be a high cervical lesion leading to a thoracic cord level. Like you can have a sensory level at the level of the dorsal cord, although the lesion is at the upper cervical. Why does this happen? Again, there are many reasons for this. One is that, there is the concept of the dropped sensory level. Dropped sensory level means that, that the sensory decussation, I mean, the spinothalamic tracts, I told you, Lissajous tracts, so they cross 1 to 2 segments above or below the area, the spinal cord region of entry. But that would explain only 1 or 2 levels, right? Not 8 to 10 levels that have been described. So it is believed that whatever lesion is happening at, say, a higher cervical cord level, that is leading to some degree of venous congestion below that level, and the venous congestion eventually leads to some degree of vascular cord problems much lower and lead to a false localizing sign even in the spinal cord. That's one kind of false localizing sign. The second kind that has been described by a similar mechanism is the presence of wasted hands in people who have high cervical lesions. Okay, wasted hands, you would think of CAT1 problems, right? But this could be people with a foramen magnum lesion even. And again, the same mechanism. It's believed that there is some venous congestion, which acts much lower down at these levels, and they lead to false localizing signs. So yeah, false localizing signs exist in the cord also.
Yeah. One more, I think we'll take one or two questions more. How do we differentiate between Todd's palsy and a stroke in an unconscious child?
Very good question, and clinically very important, actually, especially if you're dealing with acute stroke. There is no real way of telling whether this is Todd's